Luke's English Podcast is supported by donations, and if you'd like to make a donation, that would be very nice. You can do it by clicking one of the yellow PayPal donate buttons that you'll see on my website. Also, the podcast is supported through the premium subscription, and if you sign up to that, you can access over 100 video and audio episodes with PDF downloads to work on your vocabulary, your grammar, and your pronunciation. Okay, and if you want all the information and you'd like to sign up, then just go to teacherluke.co.uk/premium info. You're listening to Luke's English Podcast. For more information, visit teacherluke.co.uk. Hello, everyone. How are you doing? Hope you're doing fine today in podcast land. So, in this episode, you can learn English with the Beatles as we look at specific bits of English which appear in the lyrics of their songs. I'm joined again by Antony Rotunno from the Glass Onion on John Lennon podcast. Antony is also an English teacher and something of a John Lennon expert. He's also a musician, and a lot of the credit for this episode goes to him because he did most of the preparation, going through lyrics of Beatles songs and picking out specific use of English, including certain phrases and idioms. So this is like a quiz, actually. Can you name the songs when Antony plays them? And can you beat me? Which could be quite difficult because I'm pretty quick when it comes to games like this, especially on the topic of the Beatles. Anyway, can you name the songs from the lyrics and from the music? Antony's got his guitar with him in this episode, and he will be playing little snippets of some of the songs. So there are also a few references to the Ruttles and Neil Innes, of course. But for us, those songs are all part of the Beatles' extended universe. I will chat to you again at the end of the episode, and I'll sum up some of the bits of language that come up during this conversation. But now, let's get started.
It's funny that I'm really pleased that we're doing this for many reasons, but one of them is that I actually went through a book of Beatles lyrics, and to be honest, most of the examples I'm citing here are John Lennon's Beatles songs. I didn't find so many in the solo years, but general comments, Beatles lyrics were quite literate. They all went to grammar schools, or the main three guys, and John and Paul certainly liked Alice in Wonderland, which is where you get a lot of imagery. And when they grew up, when they were growing up in the 50s, I think Chuck Berry was probably the only songwriter who really had narratives in his lyrics. If you make a comparison, I love Buddy Holly. I could listen to Buddy Holly's 20 greatest hits forever. But the lyrics are quite simple. You know, they're great. But Chuck Berry had these like pithy kind of stories.
Chuck Berry's amazing. His lyrics are absolutely brilliant. Yeah, as you said, little stories, narratives. He was really great and very poetic and very articulate. I think he's really underestimated as a lyricist.
But the sort of tradition in those days, in the early 60s, would be simplicity. And one of the things that's very interesting, the first five Beatles singles, Love Me Do, Please Please Me, From Me to You, She Loves You, I Want to Hold Your Hand, pronouns. And it was a deliberate thing. I don't know if it was deliberate while they were writing the songs, but they clearly had it in mind. It was a way of reaching out to the fans, saying from me to you or from us to you. And they had a TV show or something, a radio show called From Us to You, anyway. So it was very direct. But do you know the story of how John Lennon came to start using more imagery in his lyrics? Do you know that?
No, I don't. I think I don't, no.
It's a sort of mixture of things. Have you ever read his books, his first two books, In His Own Right and A Spaniard in the Works?
Yeah, I've read a lot of those. Yeah, my mum and dad had those books. So they were sort of on the bookshelves growing up. And also Grapefruit, Yoko Ono's book as well. So my brother and I used to sometimes pick them up and just sort of like leaf through and see. Yeah, funny poems, basically.
Yeah, I don't know if they've been much good to our English students because they're going to totally warp their... Because there's some great like stuff. There's loads of social commentary, and there's just like it's a sort of nonsense, but nonsense in a good way. And my favourite one is he describes Princess Margaret as priceless margarine, which is just brilliant. I mean, because it's a dig. He's having a little dig at the royals, but in a gentle way.
I guess the thing about Lennon's prose is that he would sort of find ways in which words sounded like other words, and then he would turn them into those other words. Mm. Like, you know, there's that famous one about the general election. The general erection over the torches.
With a small Marjorie over the torches.
With a small Marjorie over the torches, which is a small majority over the Tories. And then something about entering Powell.
Yeah, an abscess of Powell or something. Something like that. I can't remember. I haven't read it, but we can do a show about it fairly soon. I'll send it to you when we've done it.
Okay.
As you all know, Harris Wilsard won the general election with a very small Marjorie over the torches, thus putting the Labouring Party back into Powell after a large abscess. This he could not have done without span the barking of the trade unions, headed by Frank Cunnings, who now has a safe seat in Nuneaton, thank you.
And great. Stuff like there was a politician called Alec Douglas Home, or Whom, and he has him as Alice Doubtless Whom. So you've got Alice, you know, you've got casting him as a female. There's just so much in that book, but you don't think for a second that John Lennon thought it all out. You know, it's clearly just coming out of this amazing brain that he had.
Yeah.
But what I was going to say was that he did an interview with a BBC journalist called Kenneth Allsop. And after the interview, Kenneth Allsop said to John Lennon, "I've noticed, you know, why don't your song lyrics have all this clever imagery in them?" And he said, "Well, you know, I think if song lyrics is one thing and writing is another thing." And he said, "Well, why don't you do that?" And John Lennon thought, And then when Bob Dylan, marijuana, and LSD came into his life, that was really where the transition came. Mm-hmm. So suddenly you get all this imagery. So there's a definite sort of demarcation point, really, around 65, I'd probably say, maybe even 64, where the lyrics started to change. And Paul pretty much kept up with him. Yeah.
People often say this is another the sort of John Paul dichotomy, which is not really the case, that people often sort of reductively say John Lennon was the lyrics guy, Paul was the melody or music guy. But it's not, that's also not really true, that Paul came up with great lyrics and John also had some great melodies in there too. But actually looking through a list of Beatles songs that I've got on Spotify, and I was thinking, I wonder which songs I would pick in terms of lyrics. Almost all of them were John Lennon songs. There are a few Paul ones in there too, like I love Fool on the Hill, She's Leaving Home, and a lot of his songs. But oddly, the ones that stuck out for me are John's songs.
Mm. Yeah. Well, George Martin said it best, and I mean, he was there, you know, he was their producer. He said, "John saw songs as lyrics that needed music, and Paul saw songs as music that needed lyrics." So there you have it. You know, it's not an either or, you know, it's not 100% either way, but
yeah.
I think that's fair enough.
Yes, I think so.
Can I show you? These are all my examples. I'm not going to be able to go through all of them, am I? See, I've done my homework there.
Let's just do what we can in the time that we've got.
Okay.
As a general rule of life.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll let you choose and pick and choose whatever you want to do.
Okay. Well, I might sing a few, and I've got my guitar here. I'm not going to be giving performances. Don't worry. But I try to divide these into sections. But I'll get you to let's do Guess the Song. So I'm going to love her till the cows come home. I'm going to love her till the cows come home.
When I get home.
Very impressive. This is deep Beatles. When I get home. This is not well-known songs. I got a chip on my shoulder that's bigger than my feet.
I'll Cry Instead.
Very good. So you got The Cows Come Home, Chip on My Shoulder, which we talked about.
When the cows come home, meaning sort of, you know, for a long time, I'm going to do something until the cows come home. The cows come home, meaning for a long time.
Yeah. And it's funny that those two lyrics – he gets sort of a bit lambasted for. I mean, they're a bit clunky. I've got a chip on my shoulder that's bigger than my feet. It's not the greatest lyric in the world. Well, my heart went boom when I crossed that room, etc.
Yeah. She was just 17. Saw her standing there, of course, yeah.
Yeah. That's My Heart Went Boom. So that's an onomatopoeia. You know, you make the sound of it like buzz or hum. So boom,
boom, yeah. Boom, boom. Your heart, his heart went boom as he crossed that room. Yeah,
that's it. This one you won't have to guess because this is the title. It won't be long till I belong to you. So a little bit of wordplay. It won't be long until I belong to you.
Very nice.
That was quite nice.
Yeah.
Easy one. I don't know why she's riding so high. She ought to think twice, she ought to do right by me.
Ticket to Ride.
Ticket to Ride, very good. So riding so high, it's the idea of being really happy, I suppose, yeah?
Riding yeah, so I high. Sort of imagine like riding high in the saddle, like as if she's up on a horse, and which suggests that maybe she's even on her high horse, which is like when someone feels morally superior. But I don't know why I've always wondered about that. I don't know why she's riding so high. I don't know what he means really about this girl.
I think there is a drug connotation as well. They loved putting those sort of sneaky references in. So it's a bit like that. I think riding so high would be like if you're on a high, if like your life's going well or something. That's the way I look at it.
She ought to think twice, she ought to do right by me. Meaning, I don't know why she's feeling so pleased with herself.
Yeah.
She should, you know, please me.
Yeah.
There's a lot of that in John's songs.
I think they were still at the point where the lyrics didn't always really make sense. It wasn't really a narrative, you know. I think that came a bit later.
Yeah.
Should we carry on? I don't know the chords for this. I'll make a point of taking her away from you. Watch what you do.
Yeah, well, you treat her. What else can you're going to lose that girl.
Very good, yeah. So I'll make a point of, I'm going to make a special effort to do this. I'll make a point of taking her away from you.
Yeah, I'm going to make a point of taking her away from you. The lyrics in that are great.
Yeah, yeah, it's brilliant. Here we go. I sat on a rug, biding my time, drinking her wine.
It's Norwegian word, open brackets, this bird has flown, close brackets.
And the bird may refer to the English word for lady. This bird has flown. This bird has flown.
That's a great song, but that's got kind of a story to it.
Yeah, yeah. He was having an affair. We actually know. I mean, this is kind of the dark side of John Lennon. He was having an affair with a lady called Sonny Freeman, and they actually lived in the flat upstairs or downstairs. I can't remember. So John and Cynthia are on one floor. Robert Freeman, who was a photographer who took some iconic photos of the Beatles, and his wife or girlfriend, well, his wife, yeah, Sonny Freeman. And John and Sonny Freeman were having an affair. Norwegian wood refers to this sort of very modern furniture. So the idea was that this is kind of a modern lady. And it's interesting as well because she leaves him, what was he, lying in the bath? No, sleeps in the bath. So she kind of does what she uses him almost. Uses him for what she wants, and then they set the house on fire, which apparently was Paul McCartney's idea.
Yeah, at the end of the song, they actually burn down the house. Yeah, it's definitely worth a listen. Yeah, we could, you know, I could go into these song lyrics in more detail, maybe pick out one or two songs and do them, which is something I plan on doing in the future. But this is great. Let's keep going.
Okay, that was Biding My Time, by the way. So biding my time, taking my time to see what happens, you know.
Yeah, to bide your time. One thing, I feel like you're going chronologically here. Am I right?
A little bit. I might be, a little bit. I kind of put it into sort of wordplay, and then I've got some stuff on colours, which is quite interesting.
Yeah.
And then we get to the surreal imagery. So yeah, in a rough chronology, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Please don't spoil my day, I'm miles away. And after all,
I'm only sleeping. Dun, 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 dun,
dun. There you go. I'm miles away. So again, brilliant double meaning, because again, it's almost certainly a sort of a pot reference. But I'm miles away means I'm daydreaming. I'm not paying attention. You know?
You always get like there's always one student in your class as an English teacher who's not focusing. Mm-hmm. They're staring out the window, and you're like, you know. Saying their name, Sergio, or whoever it is.
Yeah.
Sergio's like, huh? And Sergio! And he's like, he's miles away.
Like, yeah, if he said to you, sorry, teacher, I was miles away, you'd be impressed.
I'd be like, you knew that. Sorry about that, Luke. I was miles away, meaning I wasn't concentrating. I was in a daydream. Yeah. You get bonus points for that, for sure.
Oh, this is a good one, yeah. If she's gone, I can't go on. Feeling 2 foot small.
You've got to hide your love away.
Very good.
It's the song. Now,
Now, the good thing here is that this is a, the Beatles liked happy accidents. So the original lyric was feeling 2 foot tall, but I think he just sang by accident feeling 2 foot small. And of course it worked perfectly because then suddenly you're feeling small, like you're very insecure, lacking in confidence.
But is it a phrase that is sometimes used, like to feel 2 foot tall?
No, I think you'd say I feel 10 feet tall, wouldn't you?
Right.
That's what people say. Again, it's a bit like riding so high. You're just feeling really happy with everything.
It's interesting to sort of understand how maybe in song lyrics you get from a phrase that people know that's commonly used, and the songwriter has gone from that place to another place, which creates a sort of interesting image or something. So I feel 10 foot tall. It's like what you'd say if you felt really proud of yourself. Like, you know, well done, you've got the award, you know, here you go, congratulations, how do you feel? Oh, I'll tell you what, I feel 10 foot tall. I don't know why I'm doing it in a northern accent, but I am.
So I feel
10 foot tall. This is amazing. But then John singing, feeling 2 foot small, meaning, I guess, feeling the opposite of proud of yourself, feeling kind of ashamed or belittled or something.
I know what you mean. I don't know how you get from 10 feet tall to 2 feet small by accident. But I think maybe the genius is going with the accident. Maybe that's something that they almost pioneered. They all had that sense of, well, if I got it wrong, but that sounds better than the original lyric. Go with it.
Yeah.
I think they were lucky. The big part of their – I'm not going to say big part of their success because that was a bone of contention, but George Martin, they 100% had the best producer they could possibly get.
Yeah.
And I think he was on board with that, although he comes across as a bit sort of, weirdly enough, do you know that he was actually apparently more working class than any of them?
Mm.
But he suddenly got this posh accent, and then it was like, oh, yes, chaps, you know.
Okay, boys. Let's take it from the top, okay, boys. He's got absolutely cut glass, upper class English accent like this, and he's, you know, thoroughly posh. But he came from a very poor background, and this was in the days when acquiring that accent was considered fine, in fact a good thing to do, that it was all part of bettering yourself, and that's why it's called, I guess, why it's called received pronunciation, because you sort of receive it, you learn it. So he you know, put on this very posh voice and sort of worked his way up into this top job in a top recording company. And he did sort of an amazing success story himself. I mean, the Beatles story is just full of these incredible individuals who just, I guess, by chance all ended up working together. But
it was amazing.
You were saying George Martin was perfect for them because he also had worked with comedians before and stuff, and so he was able to incorporate the comedy of the Beatles into their work. It didn't put him off. Like some producers would have been unable to deal with it, and they were like, you know, oh, I can't handle these Beatles. But George, you know, was encouraged it and liked it and was able to work with it.
100%. They all had this subversive side. I think that's what it comes down to.
Yeah.
So again, taking something that people know and then subverting it, just sort of changing it a little bit.
That's kind of what I mean when I say that in the Beatles lyrics are, they've got sort of jokes in them, but not full on blatant jokes, but there are things that I feel refer to other phrases or other things that everyone knows, and they twist them slightly, like changing certain phrases with other words to give a slightly different flavor. And I feel like I sometimes wonder if American listeners pick up on the same bits of humor in the Beatles lyrics as Brits do, you know?
Yeah.
But I guess for American listeners, it just adds extra quirkiness, an extra kind of originality, even if they don't necessarily understand everything. It sort of adds color and character to it.
Maybe they just pick up on it again without realizing exactly what it is.
Yeah.
The Ruttles just came to mind. One of the geniuses of Neil Innes, who wrote those Ruttle songs, was taking the idea of using phrases, and then this is just amazing. For the song Help, he came up with a song called Ouch. Ouch, you're breaking my heart. And he talks about upsetting the apple cart. So he's doing this brilliant thing where the Beatles didn't generally use necessarily idioms and proverbs, So Neil Innes had the thought, well, why don't I use some really kind of clunky idioms for comedic effect? And, you know, there's a song, All You Need Is Love. He did Love Life, where there's a will, there's a way. It's brilliant.
There's another one in that. All his lyrics, including his non-Ruttle stuff, are full of these sort of platitudes, these sorts of like sayings that your mother would know. Where there's a will, there's a way. Oh, no, it's just where there's a will, there's a way. But some of his songs, some of his other songs that are not Ruttle's ones, are almost entirely made up of those kinds of sayings. Like, do you know the one Spaghetti Western? I don't know if it's a bit...
I don't know if I've heard that, actually.
It's a bit obscure.
Spaghetti Western.
Yeah, it's from his Innes Book of Records TV show, and he also recorded the song for one of his albums, and it's a kind of pastiche of a spaghetti western song.
Like a gunman wears a gun, he wore a gun, and people stepped aside because he was no good. 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 Because of bad luck, he never knew a mother's love. He was like a wolf in sheep's clothing, or an iron hand in a velvet glove.
And people stepped aside because he was no good. And it's not because he was no good, like, morally, but literally he was no good with the gun. Like, he couldn't shoot straight. That's why people were stepping aside. And other things like, he was no good because of bad luck. He never knew a mother's love. He was like a wolf in a sheep's clothing or an iron hand in a velvet glove. And
brilliant. It's almost like he's taken a list of idioms and thought, which ones can I use?
Yeah, absolutely.
But there wasn't the internet then, was there? So,
I think it was brilliant. All in his head. I think, you know, that's just the genius of Neil Innes. Yeah.
Well, there's a great bit of wordplay, actually. The song that's supposed to be Get Back is called Get Up and Go. Get up and go. But he has a great double meaning of it. He had a lot of get up and go, which is obviously a lot of energy.
Yeah.
And then he says, get up and go back home. Get up and go back home.
He didn't have a lot of what you might call luck, but he had a lot of get up and go. Get up and go. Get up and go. Get up and go back home.
Yeah.
Just absolutely brilliant. I think comedy records are an absolute art. I mean, Brave Sir Robin from the Holy Grail. They talk about
Sir Robin. That's Neil Innes.
When danger reared its ugly head, he bravely fled, or something. He's talking about, because he runs away from the three-headed, the knights at St. E.
In the Monty Python and the Holy Grail, which follows the Knights of the Round Table, and one of them is called Sir Robin, and he's followed by his band of minstrels who play songs wherever he goes, and the lead minstrel is played by Neil Innes in the film. And so Robin is going around, and his band of minstrels are singing about how brave he is. And then when Robin actually does come across a monster, he runs away, and then the minstrels are like taunting him, brave Sir Robin ran away. And it's like, when danger reared its ugly head, he bravely turned his tail and fled. Brave, 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 brave Sir Robin. Yeah. And he's going, I didn't, shut up.
Yeah. But actually, I just remember before then, he's talking about all the horrible things that could happen. He was not in the fray. Da, da, da. And then they get to his and his penis. Oh, stop. He's talking about all the horrible things that can happen, like disemboweling and things. I don't remember that.
Hold on. It goes, it's basically bravely bold Sir Robin rode forth from Camelot. He was not afraid to die. Oh, brave Sir Robin. He was not at all afraid to be killed in nasty ways. Brave, 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 brave Sir Robin. Meanwhile, Robin's like looking slightly less happy as the song goes on. He was not in the least bit scared to be mashed into a pulp or to have his eyes gouged out and his elbows broken, to have his kneecaps split and his body burned away and his limbs all hacked and mangled, brave Sir Robin. His head smashed in and his heart cut out, his liver removed and his bowels unplugged, his nostrils raped and his bottom burnt off and his penis split and his... that's enough music now.
Yeah, when he gets the penis, he goes, oh, that's enough for now, lads. Oh, so good.
The Tale of Sir Robin. So each of the knights went their separate ways. Sir Robin rode north through the dark forest of Ewing, accompanied by his favourite minstrels.
Bravely bold Sir Robin brought forth from Camelot. He was not afraid to die, oh brave Sir Robin. He was not at all afraid to be killed in nasty ways. Brave, 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 brave Sir Robin. He was not in the least bit scared to be mashed into a pulp, or to have his eyes gouged out and his elbows broken, to have his kneecap split and his body burned away, and his limbs all hacked and mangled, brave Sir Robin. His head smashed in and his heart cut out and his liver removed and his bowels unplugged and his nostrils raped and his bottom burnt off and his penis...
That's enough music for now, lads.
Brave Sir Robin ran away.
No!
Bravely ran away, away.
I didn't!
When danger reared its ugly head, he bravely turned his tail and fled. Yet brave Sir Robin turned about.
I didn't!
And gallantly he chickened out, bravely taking
to his never did!
Bed. He beat a very brave retreat.
Oh, Lord!
Bravest of the brave Sir Robin.
I never!
Just a little, this is not, I'm not going to play this, but yeah, double meanings again. Day tripper. Could be someone going on a day trip to the beach, or again, it could be someone who takes LSD at the weekend and then has a normal straight life. So it's, again, it's almost like a quite sort of pointed social comment there. Ticket to Ride. Interestingly, there is a place called Ride on the Isle of Wight, R-Y-D-E. It may have been a sort of nod to that.
And yeah, you would go down and buy a ticket to Ride. Meaning literally a ticket to a place called Ride, which again is another little, almost like a little in-joke, I guess, between the members of the band.
That's it, yeah.
They probably did get a ticket to Ride, and that's a good name for a song, though. Should write a song about that. Ticket to Ride.
Yeah. This one, I mean, again, the title's here. It's been a hard day's night and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I've been sleeping like a log. So similes, working like a dog, sleeping like a log.
Yes, and we have so many of those similes in English.
Yeah, one thing we talk about in my English class is sleeping like a log. You can also sleep like a baby, which I always thought was a bit weird, because don't babies wake up screaming in the middle of the night?
Yeah, and they shit themselves.
Yeah.
I tell you what, I slept like a baby last night. What, you woke up crying with piss and shit in your pants? That sounds terrible.
Yeah, sounds like a bad night.
Yeah.
All right, moving on. If you need a shoulder to cry on, I hope it will be mine. Don't you be sad, just call me tonight.
Anytime at all. Down, down, down. Anytime at all. Anytime at all.
Yep. And, I think John Lennon would give people a shoulder to cry on, going back to the adjectives. I think. There's quite a lot of evidence for that, that he would be, he was quite a caring person, had that caring side.
If someone was upset, yes, to give someone a shoulder to cry on, which is like to be sympathetic to someone. You're willing to listen to their problems and let them cry on your shoulder, not necessarily literally, but there it is, to give someone a shoulder to cry on. Mm.
That's it. Where are we?
Now fine, I've changed my mind, I've opened up the doors.
Help me if you can.
Yeah,
help. My independence seems to vanish in the haze.
So a couple of things. Open up the doors. Again, we think maybe because he just had his first LSD experience, it could be to do with the Doors of Perception, the famous book by Aldous Huxley. And then my independence seems to vanish in the haze. I mean, that's quite big for mid-60s. Pop lyrics, that's quite It's not the kind of thing you'd expect to find.
My independence seems to vanish in the haze. Again, it could be a drug reference because haze could refer to like sort of smoke in the air when the air isn't completely clear. For example, if you look out across the city, you get fog or smog in the air. There's haze, there's pollution in the air. But similarly, it could be smoke in a room. And they were smoking quite a lot of, you know, marijuana at the time
for breakfast,
and so there probably would have been haze around, and his independence may have vanished in the haze, you know, his sense of his own identity being lost in the midst of this circus that you talked about, that they
yeah, it's almost like a haze of drugs and Beatles fame, you know, put those two things together and anyone would be a bit hazy.
Mm-hmm.
Right, colors. I found some color references in Beatles songs. Da, 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 where I can go when I feel low, when I feel blue, and it's my mind.
There is a place.
There's a place. Very good. Yep. So when I feel blue, it's kind of an Americanism, you know. Not the greatest lyric.
Feeling blue, though, that's, you know, that is a phrase that is used to feel blue, meaning feeling sad, feeling a bit depressed.
Not sure if people use that. Does that seem like a bit old-fashioned? I don't know.
I think people would probably say feeling down rather than feeling blue these days. But, you know, it's the sort of thing that might pop up here and there. You might notice it, but I think it's probably less than it used to be. Instead, people say feeling down, feeling depressed.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody's green. Because I'm the one who won your love. But if it's seen, you're talking that way. Da, da,
da, da. So please listen to me if you want to stay mine.
I told you before.
Oh, yeah. You can't do that.
Can't do that. Very good. Yes. Yeah. So everybody's green, green with envy. So I've got the girl that everybody wants.
Yeah.
They're all jealous or envious.
Green meaning jealous. So green is also used to mean something else as well. Green meaning inexperienced.
Mm-hmm.
So if someone can be green, especially in American English, it's the sort of thing that you notice in TV shows and stuff that we watch. If someone is green, yeah, it means they're inexperienced, I think.
Yeah, I mean, people say that about Brian Epstein, that he was sort of well out of his depth when he started.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't wasn't a pop manager, but he just had this love, genuine devotion to the Beatles.
Thank goodness. I mean, he was the driving force, I think, in many ways, like the business side of things.
Yeah, yeah.
If you wear red tonight, scarlet were the clothes she wore.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, fantastic. How good were the Beatles' B-sides? Oh, I've got a B-side here, Rain. Oh, I've got a B-side, Revolution. Not bad.
Yeah. And yes, it is. Yeah, amazing harmonies, beautiful vocal harmonies.
Showing,
again, yet more range. It was another string to their bow.
In this case, they're not really using it as anything. Apparently, his mother, Julia, used to wear red. She was using red and scarlet. Interesting, a scarlet woman. Is that a woman who's been shamed?
Embarrassed for some reason.
I thought it was more that in the old days where, you know, sex outside marriage was a terrible thing. If a woman had been found to have had sex with someone, that she was called a scarlet woman. I think that's right.
Oh, right, really?
Very old-fashioned. I mean, I don't think anyone would ever say that anymore. But.
It's the sort of thing that, you know, I mean, you know, Beatles being well-read and stuff like that, it might have been an image that there was just in their heads. But I'm checking out, yeah, scarlet woman, according to dictionary.com. It's not one of the dictionaries I normally use, but scarlet woman. Yeah, they say a sexually promiscuous woman, especially a prostitute or a woman who commits adultery. Yeah, it's certainly not something we use these days, but it's there. It's there. Yeah. And it's maybe in old books and things. So a scarlet woman. Oh, interesting that. Yeah, scarlet were the clothes she wore. So a scarlet woman. Yeah, what's going on there in that song?
Yeah, it's a bit of a tangent, but. Really, really good book called The Renegade History of the United States by Thaddeus Russell. And he appears a lot on podcasts. You'll find him. He's always worth listening to.
Yeah.
And he was saying in a weird way, he does a history of the United States, which shows you how the underclasses shaped the history. So poor black people literally put black people in poverty, their style of music and their style of dress was eventually aped and taken up by white people. And the other thing was that he makes a very controversial case that prostitutes were actually, sort of harbingers of women's liberation, because in those days, the only women who wore bright colors were prostitutes, and it was almost a way of showing that they were prostitutes, because women in general generally wore like black, white, gray, those kind of colors, and men as well, to be honest. If you look at old photos, obviously they're in black and white, but you don't see a lot of bright colors. So, and Julia was, his mother was quite promiscuous. She was quite ahead of her time in a funny way. And it's fascinating and tragic to think of, you know, what she would have been in the 60s, you know, seeing her son's fame. I mean, it's heartbreaking, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
All right. Very interesting. This is a good piece of... you don't have to guess this because this is the title. I'll play the beginning. Oh, dear, what can I do? So what are you getting?
Babies in Black.
Babies in Black. Babies in Black and I'm feeling blue. So a nice bit of black and Babies in Black and I'm feeling blue. This could be a reference to another woman, Astrid, to do with the fact that Stuart Sutcliffe had died and she tended to wear black. Which I think she wore that anyway, because it was connected with a sort of with art, you know. But yeah, nice bit of wordplay. Babies in Black and I feel blue. Yeah.
I always, you know, these little things, these little clues or hints, whenever I listen to Beatles songs, I'm always kind of speculating in my head about what they could mean. And when you say that, you know, Babies in Black, you know, it's about Astrid, who was their friend from Hamburg, and she would wear black because she was an existentialist. Exes, they used to call them. And then Stuart Sutcliffe, John's best friend, fell in love with Astrid. Although I wonder if the others like had a crush on her too. But Stuart was the one that ended up with her. And then Stuart like tragically died of a brain hemorrhage. And John would have been very, very upset about it. So Babies in Black and I'm Feeling Blue. I don't know. Is there anything to it? Maybe.
Yeah. And again, his caring side came out. Astrid has said many times, you know, he was amazing after Stuart died. Amazingly caring.
Yeah.
All right, next one. Now we're getting to sort of imagery and more sort of veiled references. When the sun shines, they slip into the shade and sip their lemonade.
Yeah, so it's rain. When the sun shines, they slip into the shade and sip their lemonade.
Well, this, again, this is very much open to interpretation, but one interpretation is it's about people hiding away from the truth. So the sun might be, I don't know, like the new liberated era, and they don't want to be part of it. So they slip in the shade and sip their lemonade. It's like they're running away from it. You know, I don't know, but I think he may have mentioned that. That's the only reason I would say that, you know, because you could almost say anything about anything, couldn't you? Mm. You know, you could read anything into these kind of lyrics, but yeah, just a B-side.
One of their best songs, definitely. And like the basis of the entire Oasis's entire musical catalogue is the song Rain. It's just like, it just sounds like the Oasis because they just copied it completely.
Yeah.
But but certainly those lyrics in that song, like John is kind of sort of showing a sort of contempt for people who he feels, I don't know which people it is exactly, but just ordinary people who have woken up, because this is in his post LSD period. And he's kind of saying, you know, aren't they stupid? You know, when the sun shines, they go outside to have their picnics and stuff. And when the sun shines, they escape from the sun. It's almost like, it could be like a bit of stand-up comedy, isn't it? Like, you know, you could twist it and turn it into a bit of observational comedy. It's like, you know, what's the deal with people? They go outside and the sun's shining. And when the sun comes out, they go in the shade. Like, do you want to be in the sun or in the shade? Like, make up your mind. Maybe best as a song. Probably best as a song, actually. And then when the rain comes, they run and hide their heads.
That's it. Hiding. Yeah, they're hiding, you know.
Yeah, always hiding away from the elements, the elemental forces that are coming towards them. going out, hiding from the sun, hiding from the rain. They run and hide their heads. They might as well be dead.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny with Revolver. There's lots and lots of references to death. I think that was a big change, you know, Rubber Soul. George said Rubber Soul and Revolver could have been part one and part two. I don't agree with that at all.
No.
I think, you know, suddenly they're talking about death, ego death, literal death. Quite amazing.
Yeah, I heard Robert Rodriguez make that very point in an episode of something about the Beatles podcast.
Mm.
And yeah, it's true. Like so many of the songs on Revolver are about death. There's like Taxman, you know, when, you know, for those who die, cover a, you know, put a penny on each eye.
Declare the pennies on your eyes. That's a great line.
Declare the pennies on your eyes.
Declare it as tax, yeah.
This is from the old tradition, which was that when people died, that pennies, coins would be put over their eyes, first of all, to cover their eyes, but secondly, to pay the person taking the body away. No?
Maybe. I don't know. Yeah, I always thought it was... Yeah, I don't know. You might be right. I know it's definitely to cover the eyes, yeah.
Maybe a payment to someone as well. But my advice for those who die, yeah, declare each penny on your eyes. So the song is about, you know, George complaining about having to pay tax. But fair enough, they paid something like 90% in those
days. There's one for you, 19 for me, which means 19 out of every 20 goes to the government.
Yeah.
I don't think that was on their whole income though.
Yeah,
that would have been on part of the income, but I mean, it is taking the piss. Let's be honest.
But yeah, so many of the songs on the album reference death in some way. Yeah, it's very dark. It's a pretty dark album.
It is, isn't it?
Even in the, you know, the last song, Tomorrow Never Knows, he's like, you know, turn off your mind, relax and float downstream. It is not dying.
This is not a line, but a song with tangerine trees and marmalade skies, cellophane flowers, newspaper taxis. What would that be?
It's Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, a couple of things about that. I'm pretty sure that Paul contributed a lot to this, and because they did have writing sessions around Sergeant Pepper. Their writing partnership tended to come sort of in and out. Rubber Soul, they wrote a lot of that together. I think when they were under time pressure, that's when they would actually get down to it and have these famous three-hour writing sessions. But, yeah, very interesting. This really is a sort of combination of Alice in Wonderland and LSD. Rather like, if you know the Jefferson Airplane song, White Rabbit,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's like, take this pill and one pill makes you larger. And that's Alice in Wonderland, but clearly it's LSD as well. And interestingly, Lewis Carroll, I read a book years ago about creativity. Lewis Carroll used to have terrible migraines, which is like a very, very painful headache. You know, it's a very extreme headache. And apparently he would get visions. So Lewis Carroll was getting psychedelic visions 100 years before John Lennon.
Lewis Carroll, the man who wrote Alice in Wonderland, and a big influence on John Lennon. Yeah, because there's always been speculation about whether Lewis Carroll was somehow using psychedelics and if psychedelic experiences had influenced Alice in Wonderland. Powerful migraine headaches can produce hallucinations and visions.
Amazing,
and things. Yeah, okay, interesting that.
I mean, just another sort of comedic note about that. We reviewed a book, very, very good Beatles book, Riding So High, The Beatles and Drugs. And it's a very, very even-handed look at their relationship with drugs, like good and bad. But they describe LSD was synthesized in a laboratory by Albert Hoffman. It was either Germany or Switzerland. Anyway, in 1943. And he famously... I think he ingested it by accident once, and then he did it on purpose, and he famously went off riding on his bike. And in the book, they quote what he wrote about this experience. And it's so funny to see like a German or Swiss scientist in 1943. I joked, he wrote Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds then, because it's not quite as surreal, but he just describes these amazing visions. You know, that's during the war, it's during the Second World War. That's decades removed from the 1960s.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Okay, so we're going to do a quick fire round now where you just say a line and I will identify the song. And we're not going to go deep into the lyrics, but we may come back for another episode at a later date where we do go into more detail about these things. So quick fire round then.
Okay. No One I Think Is in My Tree.
That is Strawberry Fields Forever.
So he's using my tree as an image of on my wavelength, basically, like I'm either a genius or I'm mad or both. Mm-hmm. Semolina Pilchard climbing up the Eiffel Tower.
That's I'm the walrus.
So that's a bizarre imagery, but it does make a reference to Sergeant Pilcher, who was the one who started busting pop stars.
The police officer who was, yeah, arresting the pop stars for possession of drugs, Sergeant Pilcher. Yeah.
Next one. The clouds will be a daisy chain, so let me see you smile again.
Dear Prudence.
Dear Prudence, so that's an image. The clouds will be a daisy chain. It's all about, it's lots of childlike imagery. Yeah. That was famously written about Mia Farrow's sister in India who would lock herself in her room meditating all day. Her hair of floating sky is shimmering, glimmering in the sun.
Julia,
yeah. So her hair of floating sky. Again, this is quite Dylan-esque. This is what he got from Bob Dylan, the idea of just putting images that don't really make sense, but they evoke a hair of floating sky is shimmering. I mean, it's a lovely image. Mm. My mother was of the sky, my father was of the earth, but I am of the universe. And you know what it's worth.
I'm lonely. The eagle picks my, what is it? The eagle picks my bones.
The eagle picks my eye. The worm, he licks my bones. Amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, blues.
Yeah, blue. So using mothers of the sky, the earth, the universe. So again, sort of nature imagery. Mm-hmm. Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy.
Across the universe.
Yeah, just again, amazing imagery. Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. This is from his solo career. As again, I didn't really find too many because I had a Beatles lyrics book, so it was easy to find them. Don't need a gun to blow your mind. Don't need a gun to blow your mind.
It's whatever gets you through the night.
Very good. Mm. So blow your mind is like, yeah, amaze you, surprise you.
Yeah.
One you mentioned earlier, no longer riding on the merry-go-round. I just had to let it go.
That's watching the wheels.
Yeah, so I think the merry-go-round here is the pop music business, right? Would you say? Like, he retired for 5 years.
Absolutely. That's what the song's all about, really. It's like him sort of like retiring from the music industry, even though lots of people don't understand his decision and everyone's like, oh, come on, don't you want to get back in the big time? And he's like, no, you don't understand. I'm just sitting here watching the wheels go around, watching shadows on the wall.
Yeah. Love it. Yeah. Love it. This is actually the last one, so we've done it. You won't have to guess the song here, but Mother, you had me, but I never had you. And a very interesting double meaning of Mother, you had me, as in you gave birth to me, but I never had you.
Yeah, he never really had a relationship with her properly. So that's from the song Mother.
Yeah.
Plastic Ono Band.
Yeah, my favourite John Lennon album by miles.
Yeah. Well, Antony, it's time to wrap up here. Meaning, end it.
Oh, can't we do another hour? Come on.
Well, maybe we can do another hour. We can do more at another time, perhaps. But I think for this particular session, it's time to call it quits here and call it a day. But this has been great. It's been really interesting. Thank you so much for talking to us all about John Lennon and the Beatles. And, you know, I'm very curious to see what the audience, you know, how the audience responds to this with their comments and things like that. But this is great. And keep up the good work with Glass Onion on John Lennon, the podcast, mm-hmm. Film Gold, the film review podcast. And the mm-hmm. third one is on, what's the third?
Life and Life Only.
Life and Life Only, the third podcast. So listeners will find links to those in the usual places. But yeah, this has been great. Again, thank you.
It's been lots of fun, yeah. It's nice to put my English teaching chops and my John Lennon chops into action. Yeah, it's been great. Thanks for having me on the show, and yeah, I'm sure we'll do something in the future.
Yes.
Come on, Glass Onion, if you want. Is there anything you want to talk about?
Well, I don't know if I could really kind of contribute that much to Glass Onion, considering the sort of level of expertise that you've had from your guests. And there's the first-hand accounts, you know, the primary evidence that you've got on there. I mean, I'm a huge fan. I can ramble, but I don't know if I'm qualified to be on Glass Onion.
We'll pretend you're the son of a doorman at the Dakota. How about that? We'll come up with something.
Yeah, maybe.
No, open invitation. If there's any, like, documentary you want to review or album you want to review. Because I haven't really – it's weird, actually. I haven't – He only made a few solo albums, and I've barely covered any of them. It's weird. I'm a bit loath to go into that territory because I think what I'm suffering from at the moment a bit is Beatles opinion fatigue, because I'm in this community and it's always fun, but someone will say, oh, that's a great song, and someone will say, no, I don't think it's a great song. And it's like, well, okay.
I find opinions to be a bit tiresome sometimes, or certainly disagreement. I don't necessarily want that. You know, what I like from my Beatles podcasts and stuff is sort of insight, you know, and anecdotes. I like stories, insights, and I also like new approaches. I just like new ways of looking at the whole thing, new perspectives and things like that. I always find that interesting. And first-hand accounts, when there are people who actually knew them. Anyone who actually ever met the Beatles or even, you know, glimpsed them once, I want the full, like, 2-hour story of it.
Yeah, it is like gold when you actually get somebody. My friend Sam, who does the Paul or Nothing podcast, he just managed to get Denny Sywell, who was one of the original Wings members. I haven't listened to it yet. I'm going to listen to it later today, but that's a real coup when you get someone like that.
Yeah. Sam's amazing. I mean, we just did however many lessons, however many episodes on John Lennon. Maybe now I have to invite Sam Wiles onto the podcast to talk about Paul, but maybe that would be a bit much. We'll see. But anyway, yeah.
I think he should, yeah. I mean, he's what I call an HVG, a high value guest.
He is fantastic. He is. Mm. He's great. He's got the gift for the gab, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay. Well, great. Antony, thank you again. And, you know, keep in touch. I'll be listening to your podcast and, you know, come back onto the podcast at some point. Definitely.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks a lot. And all the best. Good luck with the podcast and everything else.
Cheers. So there you go. Thanks again to Antony Rotunno for his contribution in this episode and, in fact, this entire series, because this is the last one now. This is the last one in the whole Beatles series that I've been doing. I certainly hope that you've enjoyed these episodes. Let me know in the comments section how they have been for you. And please do let me know what you think. Right, so during that conversation, I should also say actually beforehand, again, about Antony Rotunno and his podcasts. Don't forget to check them out. They are sort of very insightful and, you know, lots of interesting comments and perspectives and things. So there's Glass Onion on John Lennon. And then the other one is called Film Gold. And then thirdly, it's Life and Life Only. And those podcasts are all available wherever you get your podcasts. And you'll find podcast links for them as well on the page for this episode. Right. So I said earlier on, didn't I, that I'd go through some of the language. And as I sort of went, you know, as I listened to that episode again, I made a note of bits of vocabulary, phrases, and other sort of bits of use of English. And it's quite a long list, actually. So let me fly through this. I won't be going through it in the same way that I would go through vocab in a premium episode. In those episodes, I tend to take a lot more time and lots more examples and all the other things like the tests and the pronunciation practice. This time, I'm just going to kind of quickly recap some of the bits of language that came up here, just as a reminder. Okay. So, I mean, Antony made the comment that in the early years of the Beatles' songs, especially their first pop hit singles, they used lots of pronouns. It was from me to you, she loves you, I this, you that, me, us, you know, all those sorts of things to highlight the sort of personal connection that they had with their audience. Later on, they started using more imagery in the lyrics. And also just obviously bits of English crop up. So one of them was, I'm going to love her until the cows come home, which I think is from a song called When I Get Home. So until the cows come home just means like for ages, forever, basically. According to Colin, colinsdictionary.com, it just means for a very long time. Okay, so I'm going to love her until the cows come home. Next, a chip on my shoulder. A chip on your shoulder. So this basically is an expression that someone feels angry or they feel resentment because they think that they've been treated unfairly in the past. Or maybe they feel that they've got like an inferiority complex. They feel inferior in some way, and so they act up to try and sort of counterbalance that feeling of inadequacy. That's someone who's got like a bad attitude. They've got a chip on their shoulder. My heart went boom when I crossed that room. So the onomatopoeia of boom, boom, buzz, hum. These are all onomatopoeias, words that look and sound like the things they describe. It won't be long till I belong to you. Nice little wordplay. It won't be long till I belong to you. I don't know why she's riding so high, and that sort of made us think of expressions like to be on your high horse. If you're sort of taking a morally superior position in a condescending way, you can say that someone is on their high horse. I'll make a point of taking her away from you. This is nice just because of the expression, I'll make a point of doing something. Meaning I'll really think carefully about doing it, and I'll do it for a specific reason or to show people something. I'll make a point of, replying to your email first, or he made a point of answering her question directly. I'll make a point of taking her away from you. I sat on her rug, biding my time. If you bide your time, it's just kind of like you just let your time, you let the time go by. Wait, essentially. Wait for a good opportunity before doing something. So he kind of waited in this woman's apartment, sitting on her rug, biding his time, drinking her wine. This bird has flown. Bird in British English can mean a girl. So in this sense, it could be this bird has flown, meaning this girl has gone. She left. Please don't spoil my day. I'm miles away. If you're miles away, it means you're daydreaming and you're not really concentrating on what's going on at the moment. So if you are ever a student in one of my classes and you're not paying attention and I say, hey, you know, what do you think? Question three. And you've no idea what I'm talking about. Then you could say, sorry, Luke, I was miles away, and you'll get bonus points. If she's gone, I can't go on. Feeling 2 foot small. Well, we don't really say feeling 2 foot small, but you might say feeling 10 foot tall. If you feel 10 foot tall, if you feel really proud of yourself, very pleased with yourself. You're breaking my heart. Well, obviously we know to break someone's heart. To upset the apple cart. This means to upset the situation, to make the situation go kind of out of control. The apple cart would be a wooden cart used to carry apples. If you upset it, you knock it over and all the apples tumble away. So to upset the apple cart is to upset the situation, cause a problem of some kind that has to be sorted out. But where there's a will, there's a way, which is a nice expression used by Neil Innes in one of his songs. Where there's a will, there's a way. It means if you are mentally prepared to do it, then you'll find a way to do it. A will, meaning willpower, your sense of what you want to do or what you're prepared to do. Where there's a will, there's a way, meaning we'll find a way of sorting this out. He was like a wolf in sheep's clothing. A wolf in sheep's clothing, you can imagine, would be someone dangerous and sort of frightening or something, but dressed up as if they're normal and harmless. Okay, a wolf in sheep's clothing. So, you know, like a serial killer, you know, he got away with it because he was like a wolf in sheep's clothing. He seemed to be so ordinary and harmless. But in fact, underneath it, he was a serial killer. An iron hand in a velvet glove. Interesting one, this. Iron hand in a velvet glove. Let's have a look at what the internet says. Cambridge. An iron hand or an iron fist in a velvet glove, used to describe someone who seems to be gentle but is in fact forceful and determined. They've got a very sort of gentle manner, but actually they're very forceful and determined. An iron hand in a velvet glove. Okay. Working like a dog. I mean, do we say that? Have you been? All right, yeah, I've been working like a dog. I've been working hard. Maybe. Sleeping like a log. It's actually more common to say to sleep like a baby. Which is strange because, as we know, babies don't exactly sleep in the most sort of restful way sometimes. If you need a shoulder to cry on, to have a shoulder to cry on, that means someone who will be sympathetic to your problems. And you can give someone a shoulder to cry on as well. To open up the doors. Antony was talking about the doors of perception, so maybe a little hint of psychedelic influence. The doors of perception, written by Aldous Huxley, about his sort of psychedelic experiences, and it influenced that band, The Doors. So The Doors kind of represents opening your mind in the sort of psychedelic way. My independence seems to vanish in the haze. The haze, remember? A sort of unclear air, maybe smoky air or pollution, smog, the haze, fog, mist in the air. Okay. Haze, like purple haze as well, I suppose. It was another string to their bow. So we were talking about the vocal harmonies of one of the songs. And if you have another string to your bow, it means it's another skill that you have, which generally makes you stronger. Okay. So, you know, I play guitar. It's another string to my bow. There's a place where I can go where I feel, when I feel low, when I feel blue. So to feel blue, meaning to feel sad or to feel depressed or down. Everybody's green because I'm the one who won your love. Nice wordplay as well there. One who won. It sounds so similar. I'm the one who won your love. Everybody's green. So green means jealous in this context. And oh dear, what can I do? Baby's in black and I'm feeling blue. So there's feeling blue again. And then finally, just some imagery, not really specific language, just nice imagery at the end. Things like when the sun shines, they slip into the shade and sip their lemonade. And we talked about sort of possible meanings of that. With tangerine trees and marmalade skies, cellophane flowers of yellow and green. So psychedelic poetry. No one, I think, is in my tree. I mean, he means sort of on my wavelength. Meaning no one thinks in the same way as him. No one is on his wavelength. Semolina pilchard climbing up the Eiffel Tower. Again, more weird imagery. That one from I Am the Walrus. The clouds will be a daisy chain. A daisy chain, this is when you pick these little flowers which have sort of yellow in the middle and white petals. And you can sort of stick them together to form a daisy chain. The clouds will be a daisy chain, so let me see you smile again. Sort of nice, innocent stuff. Her hair of floating sky is shimmering. So it doesn't really sort of is stretching the language here a little bit. Her hair of floating sky. I mean, I don't really know what that means literally, but it's sort of imagery. You can imagine her hair floating in the sky is shimmering, glimmering in the sun. Shimmering, sort of like shining or glittering. Glimmering like gold would. And my mother was of the sky, my father was of the earth, but I'm of the universe and you know what it's worth. Meaning it's not worth a lot. Like he doesn't, he's lonely, as he says in the song. Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. Sort of nice imagery of sort of fluidity, fluency, fluid. You know, water flowing like endless rain into a paper cup. Which is a nice cadence to those words. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy. Don't need a gun to blow your mind. To blow your mind, meaning to sort of, again, sort of open your mind or educate you, so kind of open up your mind completely. No longer riding on the merry-go-round. I just had to let it go. A merry-go-round is a children's sort of ride that you might find in the park, and it goes round and round and round, and often they will sit on horses that go up and down. That's a merry-go-round. So John was sort of talking about how the music industry was like the merry-go-round, and he's no longer riding it. And then mother, you had me but I never had you. You had me meaning you gave birth to me, but I never had you because you were never really in my life. Sad at the end there. But there you go. That has been the Beatles series. Conversation with my mum. Conversation with Antony about John Lennon. The two episodes with adjectives. And then finally this one about lyrics. I hope you've enjoyed this. I will speak to you again on the podcast soon. But for now, it's just time to say goodbye. Bye, 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 bye. Wait a minute, that's not the end of the episode. I thought that it would be appropriate to finally sing another song on the guitar at the end of this episode. You know the way this works. We're at the end of the episode, so if you don't want to hear me singing, then you can just stop listening now and you've already heard bye, bye, bye and everything's good. But if you are happy to listen to me sing, then I thought I would do a song for you again. So this one is Norwegian Wood, which is one of the songs that we mentioned in this episode. Basically the story of a guy kind of being seduced by a woman and then he ends up sleeping in the bath, and it's like this weird sort of thing where they're from different worlds. Like she's sort of laughing about how she's got to work in the morning and he doesn't, and it's all weird. It's sort of like a coded story of John having an affair with someone, and she's very proud of her very trendy apartment that's decorated or made with Norwegian wood, and that's kind of the title of the song. Okay, it's 1965 from the Rubber Soul album, and here it is.
I once had a girl, or should I say, she once had me. She showed me her room, isn't it good, Norwegian wood. She asked me to stay and she told me to sit anywhere. So I looked around and I noticed there wasn't a chair. I sat on a rug, biding my time, drinking her wine. We talked until two, and then she said, it's time for bed. She told me she worked in the morning and started to laugh. I told her I didn't and crawled off to sleep in the bath. And when I awoke, I was alone, this bird had flown. So I lit a fire, isn't it good, Norwegian wood.
Thanks for listening to Luke's English podcast. For more information, visit teacherluke.co.uk.